Good to see all of you, even though we have entered the heightened phase. Now, as part of the family month, today we will talk about our parents. And we know that each of us, we have very unique and different parents. Our parents, they have different personalities, different parenting styles, and also different weaknesses. Now, some people, they enjoy very warm and loving relationship with their parents. Their parents are like their best friends. And also at the same time, even though the parents are their friends, they also respect their parents very much. But for some people, yes, if you ask them, they will say, yes, I love my parents, but then there's still a lot of buts behind, you know, because there's certain dissatisfaction that follows. And for some of us, since young, our relationship with our parents may be slightly on the rocky side. You know, perhaps our parents have hurt us knowingly or unknowingly. You know, maybe our parents, especially Asian Chinese parents, maybe they always say that, you know, we are stupid, we are not good enough, or, you know, they never praised or encouraged us, but they only smash our self-esteem. Or some parents, maybe we are born in certain families where our parents may be abusive, or they are very selfish, and they are very uncaring, or some of them, they practice sibling favoritism, and that hurts us. Or even worse, they may also affect our growing up years, say for example, when they are very quarrelsome, or even through their divorce, and so on. And for some of us, our parents may totally abandon us. You know, we never met them, or they just abandon us to some relative. So it's very different for different people. But even if for some of us, I know some of us, our parents are no longer around in this world, but if we still in our heart bore certain grievances or hurt toward our parent, then even if they pass away already, we still need to pray for healing. That every time when we think about our parents, there will not be any hatred or grievances in us, whether they are alive or not. And so because our relationship with our parents may not be perfect at a certain stage, that doesn't mean that, you know, God can never improve that kind of parent-child relationship. And so, in fact, if you think about it, parents are our flesh and blood. And these ties cannot be severed. You know, sometimes Christians always like to say, the relationship between husband and wife is the most important. Marital relationships are the most important of human relationship. But if you think about it, certain people, they are never married. And so their parents are the closest to us. And even in this fallen world, fallen society, even for those who are married, they easily change their spouse also. But we can never change our parents. And so if you think from that perspective, our parents are not just very, very important to us. In fact, they could be the most important and never-changing relationship to each of us. And that's why today in this sermon, we need to pray for us to restore our relationship or deepen, improve our relationship with our parents. So first, let us look at certain problematic relationship or rather attitude we have toward our parents. I don't know about you, but do you sense that when we are younger or when we were like young children versus when we were adult children, is there any differences in the kind of relationship we hold with our parents? Now, if you recall when you were younger, maybe some of you, you've forgotten how you were like when you were younger. But if you look around at all those young children, very, very young, maybe below 10 years old, below 8 years old, you look at how is their relationship or attitude toward their parents. Usually, those very young children, they tend to think that, wow, their parents are like the nicest and smartest person on earth. And so they love to stick to their parent. And they will even admire their parent to the extent that they think that, wow, their parents are like some heroes. You know, so they always look up to their parents. So this is usually what happens when we observe young children. But if you look around, when people start to grow, young children start to grow into adult, what happens? We may come to view our parents quite differently, because we know when we grow up, we know more, then our eyes got sharper, then we start to notice what? Notice certain failings and faults of our parents, which we didn't even realize when we were so young. And so sometimes we start to not just notice our parents' weaknesses. We sometimes even find our parents a bit eccentric, you know. There's certain funny habits, funny behavior, funny ideas that we cannot agree of. But frankly, if you think about it, some of our parents' current quirks, funny things or weird things that we cannot stand it right now, maybe after our parents pass on, those very quirks that you cannot stand now are the things that you miss most and you laugh over most. So sometimes we need to really think, you know, when we are younger children versus when we are older children, the young children tend to be easier for them to obey their parents. But as we become more and more independent, and usually the core relationship is this, as the children become more and more independent, at the same time, it also means that their parents can become less and less dependent. And so, you know, as we grow up, we start to feel more independent, and then we start to feel we are smarter and more capable than our parents. That's when, whether we purposely or we unknowingly, we start to despise them. We despise their opinions, their advice. We feel, you know, I don't need to consult my parents, even though they have life experiences. Because if I want to know anything, I go online, I research, and then we tend to find out the online information that we receive feels more credible than our parents' advice. And so we more and more do not like to listen to our parents, and we cannot stand their nagging, and we don't appreciate their love. In fact, a lot of times we think that our parents' love is not enough until what? Until they give us what we want, especially teenagers. Sometimes we know, yes, we know our parents love us, but we always think that their love is not enough until they go my way. They buy me what I want to buy. They agree to what I want. And as we grow even older, for example, when we graduated, we started out working, we get our first salary, then we start to, maybe also unknowingly, we also start to grow proud. You know, we start to feel, oh, now that we can survive on our own, I don't really need my parents so much, and so I don't have to listen to them anymore. So as we are growing up, we need to be very mindful of this thing, which is pride, that could be growing in us also. As we grow, you know, young children, they are vulnerable. They are ignorant. They are innocent. They are naive. So the pride issue may not be, there's also some tinge of pride, but maybe not so much. But as we grow up, our capability, independence grow. We also need to be at the same time mindful that another thing is growing, which is pride. And pride can be a serious source of disrespect when it comes to our parents. And God hates exactly pride. Especially pride toward the source of our life. So what is the source of our life? It is God and also the parents through whom God uses to give us life. So with our parents, when we talk about pride, when we talk about this very familiar relationship, we need to be especially mindful of this trap of familiarity breeds contempt. Because it is so easy for us to take our parents for granted. You know, and as you look around, when we see children growing up, it is not uncommon for us to notice. And I think if you reflect upon your own experience, and as I reflect upon my own experience, I also realize that as I grow up, you know, teenager, adult, and so on, sometimes it's so easy for us to become very rude to our parents. Maybe more to the mother, because mothers are not so scary and fierce as fathers. And we may also get very impatient with our parents, especially when they give us instructions or when they ask us to do certain things. In the past, most of my quarrel with my mother is when she asks me to do things. And I tend to get very impatient because I always feel like she finds me at the wrong time. So every time she asks me to do certain things, I feel it's very disruptive. It's like I'm in the midst of enjoying whatever I'm doing or rushing my homework, and then she come and bother me with this and that. So I grow very impatient. But my mother always tells me back, when is the best time to look for you? There's no good time. Every minute is disturbing you. There's no best time. And so, as the gospel message sink deeper into me gradually, I start to repent a bit. I cannot say I repent totally. I mean, I'm not perfect yet. I start to repent a little bit and show her more patience, especially so after marriage. And so, if we believers, Christians, if we are not very careful, we may end up becoming what kind of children? A kind of self-entitled children. Because, you know, the gospel, not just gospel, this generation, even the society, the younger generation or the new generation seems to feel more entitled. And when we talk about the gospel have a lot of grace and love. And when all this notion of grace and love sink into us, we may start to, you know, feel very entitled to grace, to understanding, to the extent when we think that our parents should give us this or that, do this or that for us, but we don't have to spare a thought for the parents, and we don't have to respect them. And so this is certain problematic heart and mindset that we may bear toward our parents, and that requires prayer. But in order to get out from this problematic or imperfect attitude toward our parents, we really need to understand the why. Why should we honor our parents? So once you get the logic, of course later we'll talk about the heart, but we need to be convinced in our mind. Why? Why must we honor our parent? First of all, we need to not just look at our parent. If you keep looking at your parent, at the level of your parent, sometimes it's hard because the parent's shortfall, imperfection, keeps coming back to us. And so if we want to find a strong reason to honor our parent, we must look to someone higher and more credible, more glorious, more honorable than our parents. Of course, he's God. So we need to come from the perspective and from the starting point that our parents are unique parents. God selected them to be my parents, not somebody else's parent. God deliberately designed for me to be their child. And so our parents are unique individuals given us by God. And no matter how good or bad, you know, our parents are, one thing we cannot deny. You know, some people, I know everybody's family background is very different. It's complicated. But no matter how you argue it, no matter how you know, say, my parents are not good enough, but one thing we cannot deny, and that is, no matter how good or bad our parents are, God uses our parents to give us life. You cannot deny this. No matter how much you hate it, today we can sit here. Today we can know God. We can find salvation in God. That's first beginning from the fact that God uses our parents to bring us to this world. And so when you see that God, who is the source of our life, and God, who is the one who arranged the relationship between us and our parents, from then on, then we can start to view our relationship with our parents differently. Even if they don't really deserve it, or even if our love is not strong enough. And so, of course, I understand that, you know, in this fallen world, there are certain strange parents, strange, and when I say strange is, who defy the order of nature. There are certain strange parents around who don't love their children. I mean, we cannot ignore that there are such people, such parents. But to be fair, if you look around, most parents, they love us. Most parents, they love their children. I'm talking about generally. Of course, in this fallen world, there will be bad parents who forsake their children and so on. But often, you realize the love of parents are unconditional. I mean, if you think about it, whether a person is educated or uneducated, the moment that person becomes a parent, what happens? The moment a person becomes a parent, everything changes for him or her. Okay, I use him from now on because it's him or her, but him or her very long. So once a person becomes a parent, everything changes for him. What changes? You know, his concerns, of course, will change. The way he planned his time will change. You know, what he thinks that he can do now, what he cannot do now, what time must he go home, everything changes for this person. You know, the way he organized his life. Because why? This person, from the day he becomes a parent, he knows that he needs to live and adjust his life for the sake of the child. That's how much parents have to adjust and make sacrifice for their children. And so, if a person cannot love his parents, if you think about it along the line, if a person cannot love his parents, it is also at the same time very hard for this person to love the invisible God. And that's why God gave us very clear instruction that we must honor our parents. So a few verses, you may realize the verses that I'm going to read in this sermon is different from the verses we read during the scripture reading. So the amount of verses that can be found in the Bible is so much. That tells us how much God views filial piety, how much God values this, because there's so many verses in the Bible that talks, that tells us to honor our parents. And so first of all, Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land your God is giving you. And this is not just in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, Paul says something very, very similar. Ephesians chapter 6. Here he says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on earth. So this commands benefits who? You know, sometimes we don't like God's commands. We will feel, you know, God's commands is like so hard to do. It's only for His glory. But if you look at this, the portion about obeying, honoring our parents, it benefits both us and our parents. Our parents will receive the respect and we will get the blessing. And so, if you notice, Ten commandments are only 10. But to God, in the eyes of God, honoring parents is so, so important that it make it to the top 10 position. I mean, of course, the Bible have a lot of principle, a lot of commandments, but honoring the parent make it to the top 10. That just tell us how much God wants us to honor our parents. And so from that perspective, it's not just merely about honoring parents, because in the eyes of God, when we honor our parents, it is like honoring God. And the reverse is true. When we don't honor our parents, we don't honor God. And there's a reason why God gave us parents. Now, John Piper says that one of the purposes why God gave us parents is so that we will know how it is like to have God as our own parent. Because why? Sometimes you see two sides of our parents, right? Sometimes you see the extensive love of our parents, but at the same time, you also see the cane, the discipline of our parents. Now, sometimes our parents give us very strict principles, but also at the same time, our parents also show us tender, loving care. So when God gave humans parents, it is to showcase, it is to point us to our ultimate relationship between us and God. Because God also has two sides. He loves us, He also disciplines us. He has principles for us, He also empathizes with us, and He also helps us. And so there is clear reason why God gave us this instruction. And what's the reverse of that? Now, this is a commandment with a blessing. So what is the reverse? What's the opposite from blessing? It comes with punishment. So God says in Matthew chapter 15, what happens if you do not honor your parents? So God said, honor your father and mother, and anyone who curses their father or mother is to be put to death. Now, we read something similar just now, but that was in the Old Testament. So New Testament, Jesus himself repeated this. And now you say, what is the penalty? If you read this word, this is not my word. What is the penalty of us not honoring our parents when we curse our parents? It is not just Cain a few times. Wow, you say the Bible is so harsh. We curse the parents, we don't honor them, we deserve death. Now, our parents may not threaten us. You know, sometimes our parents will, when they scold us, they will say, if you rude to me, I'll beat you, I'll scold you, I'll not give you rice, I'll cut your allowance. Our parents will not go to the extent of, I will kill you. But look at what God says. anyone who curses the parents, he deserves death. So this is very serious. And then verse 5, but you say, if anyone declares that what might have been used to help their father or mother is devoted to God, meaning to say, I should have given my father, mother this kind of allowance. Oh, but sorry, I need to give offering to God. You know, I need to pay God some money. So because I need to give offering to God, sorry, I have no money to feed you, daddy, mommy. So some people, they actually use God as excuse. So, but here Jesus told them, Jesus exposed their heart. And Jesus said, if anyone says this, they are not. And so this verse 6, they are not to honor their father or mother with it. Thus, you nullify the word of God for the sake of your tradition or for the sake of your self-interest, your own convenience, whatever. So the Bible is trying to tell us, no one can fool God. We cannot make excuses for ourselves for not taking care of our parents, even if our excuses sound very valid and noble. Even if we say that, oh, because I need to give to God, so I have no more time or money to give you. You know, some people say, oh, I need to go to church. Also, I cannot accompany you, daddy, mommy. I cannot go and visit you because I need to keep going to church. Is that a valid reason? God says no. So we cannot use God as an example, as an excuse to say that, oh, because I need to give God my time, my money, and so I have no more left for you, parents. And so, why did Jesus mention this in the Bible? Because Jesus is very well aware of what is it in our human nature. Now, in our human nature, we are selfish by default. So it is not uncommon to see, you know, children forsaking their elderly parents. Because why? Because they feel that their elderly parents are very burdensome. And even some people in the society, they start to think that maybe sometimes you check our attitude. Maybe we dare not think so of our parents. But generally, when we think of elderly in the society, some people secretly in their heart feel that elderly in the society is a burden to the economy, is a burden to the younger generation. So they despise the elderly. But why is it that the Bible elevates this fifth commandment, honor your parents? Why is it the Bible elevate this so much? Because the Bible wants to tell us that contrary to the thinking of the culture, to the sentiments of people in the society, no elderly is worthless. And everyone, including our elderly parents, they should be honored. Failing which what? We all deserve death. And so as we grow older as children, even if we are not dependent on our parents anymore, there's no way we can outgrow God's commandment to honor our parents, which is to say, we can outgrow our dependence on our parent, but we can never outgrow the need for us to honor our parent. Meaning to say, there's no one age in which we can say, oh, I don't need to honor my parent anymore because they are not putting food on the table for me, because they are not helping me, so I don't need to honor them anymore. There's no one age in which we can outgrow this command. And Jesus showed us the best example. We know that Jesus, he is God. He don't have to listen to his earthly parents. But we know from the record of the Gospels, we know that Jesus even submitted to the authority of his earthly parents, even though what? He's smarter than them, holier than them. You thought about who deserved the honor more. Jesus deserved it more. But he submitted to his earthly parents. And by doing so, we know that ultimately, Jesus submitted to his heavenly Father to the point of death. And so, if we are his followers, we really need to pray that we don't get our motivation to honor our parents from how good our parents are. We get motivated by Jesus' example. Surely Mary and Joseph is not better than Jesus, but Jesus still honor God's commandment. And but when I say to you here, I can hear certain people having certain thoughts in their mind, you know, and they lament, what if my parents are not honorable? And this is a very real issue. I mean, The Bible gives us the ideal situation, the ideal principle, what we need to do, what we should do. But in reality, when we are living in this sinful world, when sinners are our parents, it is true that often we don't feel our parents deserve the honor. You know, sometimes we think that our parent makes certain unwise decision, and because of the older generation's mistake, it impacted on this younger generation. Or sometimes we feel our parents have unrealistic expectation on us, and that causes us a lot of stress and unhappiness. Or, of course, for certain, some of us, we do not know, you know, some complicated family history. Our parents may have done certain things that truly wounded us deeply, intensely, maybe for a prolonged period of time. So some people will say, why should I honor my parent? I cannot bring myself to even honor my parent. And some people will say, at most, I can stop at not cursing my parents. But for me to honor my parent, I cannot do that. So what's the answer for this? It is a true situation, but we have to know that as far as honor is concerned, what is the criteria to get honor? What is the criteria? The criteria to receive honor is not by merits. It's not by how good a person is. It's also based on their rank. So when we say, so you honor your boss in the office, many a times we secretly think that my competency is better than my boss. A lot of ground issue, my boss don't know anything. Go to the meeting, boss have to ask me a lot of things, then he can report at the meeting. But despite that fact, we need to understand, when the Bible say honor, honor means give weight. So honor doesn't mean that it's given only when a person shows that he deserves it, he has the merits for it. But we give honor because God has put that person in a place of authority higher than us. So we need to give weight, give honor for that position. And so whether or not our parents deserve our honor, God still tells us that we should honor them out of obedience to God, because God has placed them in higher authority than us. And through them, we receive our breath, our life. Yes, they may have done certain horrible things to us, but God tells us a second thing, not just give weight because of their position. God also points us to Jesus. If we find it so hard to honor unhonorable parents, we look to Jesus. We are also undeserving of Jesus' salvation and death. But he is willing to lay down his life to save us. And after we receive that salvation, we are still not, you know, meeting the standard. We still didn't wake up and we still fall short, even after receiving the gospel. And so Jesus wants us to look at ourselves. We are not deserving. Perhaps our parents are also not deserving in our eyes, and they have caused us a lot of grief. But just as we have grieved God again and again, we have trampled on God's grace again and again, but God forgive us again and again, God points us to Jesus to help us remember that we are to forgive as he has forgiven us. And if this is still not enough, then another reason for us to honor our unhonorable parents is if the wounds caused by our parents have left such deep hurts in us, such that we realize that we cannot trust humans, not even the parents who gave us birth. And we can only turn to God, and only God is the one who will die for me, who will sacrifice for me, who is worthy of my trust. If that parents who have hurt us so much led us to this conclusion, then to a certain extent, I mean, God works good out of evil. From that perspective, then our hurtful parents, they also are a different form of blessing to us, such that their failings, their disappointments, their hurts on us really make us come to our senses and wake up from our dream to get any form of hope from anybody. Because that's the truth. We shouldn't build our hope on anyone, whether it's our parents or our spouse or even our children, because no one is perfect. They are going to disappoint us. So for all these reasons, God still urges us, honor our parents, Even if you think they are not deserving, think of me, think of God. Honor them because you honor me. And then this is one, you know, this is one opposition. You know, my parents are not worthy. But what if, but some people, when they read about honoring our parents, another question, another struggle will come to them. And they will think of another question. And that is, what if my parents are not Christians? Am I supposed to honor them also? Now, what do you think? Of course, you will say yes, right? But why? Of course, they give us life, as I mentioned, because God uses them. Another thing is, we should still honor our parents because even if they are not Christians, God still gives them common grace, common revelation of the wisdom that comes with age. Just now we read in Job, you know, the aged, they have more understanding and more wisdom. And God uses our parents under the common grace to feed us, to provide for us, to take care of us in the normal, common, conventional way. So for that, as a basic principle, we of course need to honor our parents. But if our parents instruct us to do something that we know clearly contradicts God's principle and God's word, then of course I think you know the answer, right? The answer is to obey God rather than the parents. Now this is something Asian believers, especially very traditional Asian believers, we need to struggle through. Because a number of Asians, they even place, because maybe that's the way we are taught, we even place parents above everything and even above God. So some people, they cannot become Christian because they need to do ancestor worship or whatever. But we need to understand that if we, generally we should honor our parents, but if they give us an instruction that clearly contradicts God, we still need to recognize that when you talk about honor, God's authority is higher than our parents. And here in Ezekiel chapter 20, God give very, very clear words. So Ezekiel chapter 20, here it says, I said to their children in the wilderness, do not follow, so God said, do not follow the statutes of your parents or keep their laws or defile yourselves with their idols. I am the Lord your God. Follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. So we should follow who? Follow God or the parents? It's very clear in this. God purposely lists out, do not follow your parents if they worship idols. Do not follow that part of their instruction. So if you notice, interestingly, have you ever considered the wording of the fifth commandment, honor your parents, or honor your father and mother? Why did the Bible in the fifth commandment uses honor and not obey? Because clearly, if you think about it on a practical sense, realistic sense, there will be times where we cannot and even should not obey our parents, even if we honor them. So that's why it's very interesting. The fifth commandment, the word used is honor your parents instead of obey them. Because there may be times where our parents cause us to sin against God, or there also may be time where our parents, they are not in their right frame of mind. You know, maybe our parents are depressed. And also, when our parents are not in the right frame of mind, they may ask us to do certain things that may harm them or even harm others or harm you. And so under that kind of situation, we need not obey them. And so when the Bible tells us to honor our parents, does it mean that we have to agree with them in everything? Of course, if you have parents, you know this is impossible. Not just whether you should or not, this is impossible. Impossible for us to agree with them on every single thing. But the Bible also didn't demand that honoring our parents means we agree with everything that they say or that they think. But nonetheless, even if we do not agree with our parents in everything, we still can honor them. We still can cherish them. And we can still recognize their worth and their position in our life. So this is God's clear instruction. We cannot say, oh, I cannot honor my parents because they are not honorable, because they are not Christian. God have set the example and instructions for us. Another reason why God really wants us to honor our parents is we need to understand God is a comprehensive, holistic God. So when God gave us this instruction to honor our parent, it has further implication. Because how much we can submit to authority, that depends on how much we learn to honor our parents. Say for example, we in our whole life, there's different people, different authorities that God has set for us to obey and submit to. There are people like our government, that's why we are all wearing masks now. There are people like our boss. There are also people like church leaders. And for sisters, we are called to submit to our husbands. And so, since young, God is very wise. When we are young, when we are at our most teachable age, God wants to train us in the virtue and in the humility of learning to submit to authority, which is, of course, first, our parents. So if you think about it, if a person does not know how to honor his parent, you know, even his own parents, the parent who gave everything for him, provide everything for him, love him so much unconditionally, if a person cannot love his own parents, chances are he will also find it very hard to obey the boss who doesn't love him, only give him instruction. Chances are, it's very hard for him to obey the government who is very distant from him. And chances are, he will not submit so easily to a husband or to a church leader in future. And if you also think carefully, if a society is full of children who cannot and did not honor their parents, you just take a second to imagine what kind of society is that. If a person don't even want to honor the parent, treat the parent harshly, forsake the parent, what kind of society is this? It's not just a family problem. A society that is full of children that ignores and forsake their parents will be a society full of evils. You know, people just live as they wish. They just, it will be a very chaotic and messy society. And there's a reason why, since young, God instituted, God wants us to train our children to obey the parents, and so it creates a broader order for the entire society. And so God does think not to bind us, not to, you know, bind us unnecessarily. He has his own reason. And so after hearing all this, the why, so first we talk about certain problematic attitudes toward parents. Second, we talk about why should we get out of those problematic attitudes. Now third, of course, if you have been convinced by now, we need to ask the how. So how can we honor our parents? Now, this question is easiest answered when we talk about young children. So young children, very young children, I'm talking about those very young, primary school and below. Actually, when you reach 11, 12 years old, you start to have a bit of your own character and personality. It's harder to obey already. But for young children, very, very young children, the best way to honor our parent is to obey them. Actually, it's not just by the rule only. It's also it also makes most perfect sense, because compared to very, very young children, of course, it's more likely that their parents will know better, right? I mean, now if I'm adult, or if you're adult, you may not think that your parent knows better than you. But if you're very, very young, chances are, and logic will tell us, our parents will know better than us, so we should obey them. But the question is, what about adult children? So most of us here, except for some teenagers, most of us here, we are adult children. So how can we, you know, adult children, and just now I mentioned, we may not obey our parents in everything, right? Although we try to, if it makes sense. So a few things we need to consider as adult children. How can we honor our parents? So first of all, we need to restore this mindset that our older parents or elderly parents, they are not someone for us to endure. You know, a lot of people say, I tahan, tahan, I bear with my parents. They are very weird. They have some funny habits. You know, they have very strange nagging. I need to endure our parents. Now, parents, especially elderly parents, are not there for us to endure. But God put them in our lives for us to minister grace and love to. So, you know, in the past, we received love from them. And God's actually using our parents to also shape our character, to also put, just now we read one verse, to put our what? Religion into practice. Now, so as our parents are different from us, and as we are told to honor them, we need to come from the perspective that God put them in our life for us to minister to them. Because we also have to recognize and remember that our parents, they are also fallen humans. Meaning to say what? They are also under the attack and they are also tempted by the devil, by sin, by the world. And because of that, our parents need or don't need our prayers. They need our reminders. They even need our shepherding. You know, especially some elderly, if they easily worry, they need us to bring back the sense of peace from the word of God, you know, to remind them you don't have to fret, you know, don't have to worry so much. So if we remember that our parents are also sinners under bondage, then we can develop compassion for them more easily. And the next thing, practically, how should we honor our parents? The next point is what we should pray about. That is, we should pray about accepting them for who they are. I mean, we can hope for them to change in certain areas, and we can encourage them to change in certain areas, but up to a point, if we are grown up and we have been with our parents for long enough, we know that there's just certain things in their life, certain quirks that they cannot change. Maybe they were just... like to talk very loud, or they will just like to impose certain things on us. I mean, for certain harmless things, I mean, we, in order to honor them, that's how God, you know, led them. That's how God, that's the kind of personality that God has given them. So sometimes, even if it gets a bit on our nerve, and after praying and going through the struggle with them for some years, I mean, especially for older people, it's harder for them to change. Truthfully, in certain areas, we need to pray that if we want to honor them, we accept them for how they are. But there's this exception, unless it concerns their salvation. Unless the thing that they cannot change or the thing that they are stubborn with is concerning salvation and the gospel, then we cannot let it be. So if our parents, they reject the gospel, we cannot just simply accept it. Oh, you know, I've talked to my parents. They just don't want to become Christians. I just leave it. You know, I respect them because we need to honor our parents. We should respect their choice. I mean, if it concerns the gospel, even if they reject the gospel, we must try for our whole life to convince them that they need the eternal salvation. Because we need to be... I know this sometimes is a bit... difficult for us because we don't want to make our parents unhappy, for example, if they are non-Christian. But we need to realize that allowing our parents to hold on to non-Christian belief, this is definitely not respecting them. Because you think about it, if our loved ones, okay, this applies whether it's adult parent to very young children, or now you are slightly grown up children toward your non-Christian parents. The same thing applies. If our family members, if our loved one, they are making certain choices because of their ignorance, because they do not know what is best, they do not know the full truth, and so they choose wrongly. We have a duty, if we know the truth, to point them back to the truth. This applies if I'm the adult parent, my little child do not know what is the right way to go, do not know that he shouldn't be crossing the road when the red light is on. I, who know the truth, I need to point them to the truth. I cannot say you choose, you want to cross the road when it's red light, you cross is green light, you choose yourself. We cannot give them this kind of liberty because they do not have the capacity to make the right choice. Same thing for our parents. If our parents... without knowing the full truth, without knowing the gospel, without knowing heaven and hell, they choose wrongly, we cannot say, oh, out of respect for them, I honor their choice, or I let it be. Because the greatest filial piety we can show our parents it's not merely to care for them, you know, materially or emotionally, but to care about their eternal fate. I mean, if you think about this current pandemic, how many of us, we are so afraid and so worried that our elderly parents, they got infected by COVID-19 virus. And if we are so afraid that our elderly parents got contracted by this virus, and we say, oh, whether our parents, in the end, they go heaven or they are doomed to hell, I don't really care, you know. Can we honestly say that we love our parents if we don't care about their eternal fate? So sometimes we are very much influenced by our here and now emotions. Here now, right now, we saw the pandemic so dangerous. We tell our elderly parents, don't go out so much, you know, take care of yourself, don't get infected by the virus. We are so afraid that if they got the virus, you know, their body cannot take it. But how about their soul? If we don't really do our best, I mean, of course, even their salvation is in the hands of God. But if we don't do our best, how can we say that we really love them? So caring for their salvation is the most important form of filial piety. And of course, then once you know this, the following pointers that I'm going to mention will be very common sense to all of us. Because the next one that I'll mention is, how do we honor our parents? The most common sense thing and the basic minimum is to take very good care of them physically. And this common verse, 1 Timothy chapter 5, anyone who does not provide for their relatives, especially for their own household, has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Of course, here, I think we know basically it refers to physical needs. But it's not just about meeting our parents' physical needs, like, you know, give them food, give them money, a roof over their head. But it's also about meeting their emotional needs. Because our parents also have emotional need for love and concern. You know, some children, they do all the essential things. They have all the essential actions. They give their parents allowance. They also even visit their parents. But the strange thing is, while they are doing all this essential thing, they may not be honoring their parents with their attitude. Meaning, yes, they give money. Yes, they visit. But they do it a bit grudgingly, you know. I still have to give them this money. I am so busy and tired, still have to visit them. You know, they silently have this a bit of grudging. Okay, but I still have to do all because, you know, I have the duty. I still have to give them the money. You know, still have to spend time with them. But we need to really reflect. Are we honoring them in action because we have to do the essential? Or we are also honoring them from our heart? And if you are honoring them from your heart, God will impress on you not just to do the basic minimum, but you will think of way to what? To delight them. You know, if we are just doing for the sake of doing, we're just, okay, I'll give you the money already. Don't complain. But if we do it from our heart, we will think of ways. Just like, you know, when you take care of your children, you don't just give them the milk and give them the allowance. You think of way to connect with them, to amuse them when they are young and when they are older, to talk to them. Same thing applies for our parents. And so, Proverbs, here it says, may your father and mother rejoice. May she who gives you birth be joyful. So in that, so in other words, the Bible also prompts us to make our parents happy, delight them. And so you ask, how to make them happy? I'm not going to give you the formula. Because why? There's no hard and fast rules about this. Because all our parents are different. But even though all our parents are different, I still think that there will be certain commonalities across different types of parents. So if you think carefully, every parent generally will like their children to be close to them, to be intimate with them, especially when our parents retired already. When they retired, they have more free time. And when they retired, their source of worth is no longer built upon their job achievement. Like, you know, when we are in the middle age, when we are young, when we just graduate, when we are in the middle age, a lot of our time is spent on work. And at the same time, a lot of our achievement, our sense of satisfaction also come from the work recognition that we got from our boss or whatever. But suddenly, you know, when the elderly parent, they have no more work to do, they may start to, you know, feel like, what's the purpose of my living? I cannot contribute to the workforce anymore. And so it is at this moment, at this phase of life, that they desire more of the kind of intimacy with their children. So spending time to talk to them, in fact, not really talk to them, hear them, because I think most of the time, my experience with my parents is I ask them one question, they can tell me a lot of story. So it's very easy to communicate with them. Just ask one question and then give them your ears. They have a lot of things to say. So whether it's talking or listening, give them the time. And they love it if we seek to understand them. Not just, you know, talk randomly, but understand, you know, what their concerns are, what their worries are. In fact, try to understand, you know, last time why you make me do this silly thing? Why do you give me this weird instruction last time? Or help them help to understand what really makes them happy and what really will, you know, make them kick up a big fuss. And having all this understanding will resolve a lot of tension, misunderstanding between parent and child. And so, when we want to talk to our parents, sometimes we also realize, depending on our parents' needs, I mean, all of us, our parents have different profile. So depending on our parents' age, they may be struggling with very different issues. You know, some parents, they may be struggling with loneliness. Some is boredom, especially after they have no more work. Some, they struggle with health concerns, health worries. Or some parents, they struggle a lot with certain life regrets. You know, every time they recall a certain incident in their life, wow, they are full of lamentation and grief. I mean, depending on what our parents are struggling with at this phase of their life, we really need to pray for God to use us to address their needs and pray for them. And in fact, when we pray for our parents, one useful thing is to really let our parents know that we are praying for them. You know, some children, they are very modest, or their relationship with their parents are a bit strange, not so close. So they don't even let their parents know they are praying for them, although they'll be praying secretly for their parents for very long. But in fact, if we tell our parents that we are praying for them, this can encourage them, because they know, you know, our concern. And not just our concern, letting them know that we are praying for them is a good chance to impress the gospel on them if they are non-believers. You know, as they see how our prayer, you know, works and bring about certain effect, slowly and gradually, this gospel, this Jesus, becomes realer to them. And so we can let them know they are always in our prayers, meaning on our minds. Okay, then the next thing, besides understanding them, is of course something that I don't know how often we do it, and that is we do not just refrain from despising our parents in their old age, but we need to learn to give them credit when they are due. Meaning to say, we can tell them sometimes, you know, I've learned certain virtue because of you. Maybe I've learned how to be very frugal because of your life example, because of your teaching. Or I've learned to be very diligent or honest because of what you have taught me. Sometimes we need to do this thing that we always forget, and that is express appreciation. I mean, this is a very simple thing. In fact, it's also free, you know, very easy. Spyrite should be easy to do. But we seldom do it. You know, nowadays, since I got married 8 years ago, every time I go back home for dinner, I will always thank my mother for the dinner. But I almost never did it when I stayed with her, because I take it for granted. You know, she has to serve me dinner every day. But after I got married, every time I went back home, I'll thank my mother for the food, and she'll be so happy, you know. Aiyah, why you say thank you? You know, this is what I always do. Right? So I will praise her. I say, wow, your cooking is the best. I will love your cooking the most. Of course, I eat a lot also. I really eat a lot when she cooks. So every time I go back, so when I bless her, she also bless me. The commandment benefits both, right? You honor your parents, they receive the respect, we get a blessing. So every time I go home, she will cook like 5 dishes and 1 soup. Wow, so it's like a grand affair. So every time I go home, I look forward to her feast. And every time when I say thank you, I can see her smile. She tried to hide her smile, but there's this don't know if smile or not smile, and she will say, okay, just come back and eat more often. But it's a very simple thing. But it makes her, you know, last time when I stayed with her, not that I remember, I recall. Why is it that last time when I stayed with my mother, she always lose temper during dinner time and after dinner time. I don't know why. So sometimes me and my sister got fed up. We say, can you stop cooking? Because every time you cook, you lose your temper. No, we eat with a lot of fear and trembling. No, I'd rather we pack food home. But then I realized, oh, last time when I stayed with her, I never really thanked her. No, I never thanked her before. I just eat the dinner, go out and watch TV, and she hide in the kitchen and do a lot of things. And at the end of the day, she will come back and scold all of us. All of you don't know how to help me. But when I got married, she cooked even more. When I stayed with her, only 3 dishes and 1 soup. When I got married, 5 dishes and 1 soup. She didn't complain. And she keep doing that, you know, every week. So a simple appreciation matters a lot to our parents. And as they age, one very important thing is we need to help our parents still sense their worth and feel useful. And so we can try to seek their advice every now and then. I think the parents will love it. My mother loved it when I seek advice from her, how to cook this and that, and how to do certain household things. Actually, they are very simple, but I don't know why I don't know how to do. So when I ask her, she'll be very happy and enthusiastic to offer me a lot of advice, and she feels very happy about it at the end of the day. But I realized it's not about me asking her whatever. They feel cherished and honored when we take their tips and advice seriously, when we cherish their advice. It makes them feel that they are still useful and worthy. And of course, another practical way, this is not exhaustive list, but another very practical way of making our parents happy and honoring them is what? Is this very practical act of mutual sibling love. This is something that many parents will love it. When we, last time, my parents, they always will scold me and my sister when, we quarrel for the slightest thing, we don't have equal number of grapes on our plate or whatever. And we start to quarrel. And then the parents will say, you all really grieve us for giving birth to you. We give you so many things, not because you don't have enough grapes, then you start to kill each other. I mean, this is a bit exaggerating. But they always tell me one thing. If you love one another, love each other, that is the greatest gift for us. And sometimes they even add, I can die without regrets, because I think they seem to think that if I die, then you all can take care of each other. But if you're always like in rivalry, when I die, I'll die with a lot of worries, whether this family will fall apart. So actually, some very practical thing, it doesn't take a lot to delight our parents. Of course, living with our siblings sometimes is also difficult. Siblings sometimes are not the easiest person to live with, because they also take us for granted. We also take them for granted. But out of love for the parents, we can practice mutual sibling love so that our parents can be at ease and they'll be happy and they'll be so comforted, to see brothers loving each other. And so, although I said many things in one word, or summary, honoring our parents are not just done with material means, or giving them some money, just like that. Honoring our parents should be done with our heart, meaning with love, with real love. And when love is involved, it's boundless. It's not limited by a set of formula, what you must do, how much you must give per month. When love is involved, the extent is limitless. And God will inspire us how to do better. And so when we love our parents, importantly, we also need to keep telling them how much we cherish them. Let them know. Some people say, I love them in my heart. I love them in my heart only. But we really need to convey the message across. Let the parents sense and know clearly that we love them, we cherish them. Then they can be delighted and comforted. I know sometimes, for certain family with a certain set of family dynamics, the family members are not so used to openly saying, hey, I love you, you love me. But as I grow older, I realize sometimes, although it's a bit mushy to say, I love you, Papa, Mama, or what, But I think sometimes a little bit of awkward mushiness is still quite sweet. You know, people will laugh about it. Hey, why you say this today? But when the parent go back and think about it, wow, there's this sweetness in the parent's heart. So this is something we can practice. Not just love them, but let them know. And finally, if we know how to honor our parents, what naturally happens is we will also learn how to honor the elderly in our church. We will know how to value them and not think that, not have the contemporary kind of society values on elderly, but we will treat the elderly in the church with dignity and honor as well. So in conclusion, whether our parents are good enough or not, God wants us to honor our parents in obedience to Him. And when we do that, we not just glorify God, we also bring upon blessings upon ourselves. And this is God's clear promise. He promised when we honor our parents, we will be blessed. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, we want to thank you for this message on the parents. Lord, we first of all thank you because you are our greatest parent. You are our Father God. And Lord, you demonstrated to us what is selfless love, what is unconditional love. Lord, even though sometimes it's very hard for us to love fellow sinners, even if they are our parents, there could be certain unforgettable hurts that our parents have left inside us. But Lord, we pray that the grace that we receive from you, the forgiveness that we have received from you, the love that we have been nourished by you, can give us the driving force to also extend this grace and love to our parents, even if they are not perfect, even if they have hurt us. And Lord, please help us know how to do better, to care for our parents' salvation if they are still non-believer, and help us to also do better in terms of how to delight our parents, to glorify you, and to bring comfort to them in their old age. So Lord, we thank you for giving us parents. Lord, pray that you continue to work through your word. And I pray all this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.